What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Java keywords. There is quite a few of them. So I am going to try and do my best to cover in this video the most used and most important ones out there. To do this, let's start with a practical approach and take the famous bank account class, give it an account ID, a balance, and two methods, a deposit and a withdraw one. Now, if we choose to make the balance attribute private, it means that we restrict its access to the inner workings of its own class. So, in our class, only the deposit and withdraw methods can access the balance attribute. Methods can also be made private. So, if we were to create an apply interest method with private access, this method will only be accessible by the deposit and the withdraw methods of our class, and won't be accessible by other parts of our application. Now, what about our class itself? Can we declare a class as private? Well, think about it. If we declared the bank account class as private, it wouldn't make any sense. Who would use it then, if none of the parts of our application has access to it? However, you can declare a class as private if this class is an inner class. So, if I were to create another class inside the bank account class, let's say a travel rewards class, and we know that this class will only be used by our bank account class, then we can set the access to this class as private. Okay, what if we choose not to put anything next to our attributes? This will make them fall in the default behavior, and they will be considered as package protected. Concerning packages, it is better to see it in code. So here you can see, I placed the bank account class under the package com.geekific.package1 and created a main class under the same package. What I can do now is access the account ID directly, as you can see, without the need for setters and getters. However, if I go ahead now and create another package, geekific.package2, and create another main class under this package, I will not be able to access the same variable. The package protected access proves to be very useful and is widely used when trying to test out classes. So if I were to create a test class for our bank account class under the same package name and use this default access behavior, only the test class will be able to use these variables. And at the same time, we restrict the access to these variables to the external parts of our application. Now, on the other hand, if we choose to mark an attribute as protected, it means that this attribute will be accessed directly without the need for setters and getters by any other class belonging to the same package of our class, just like the default behavior we just saw. And in addition to this, they will also be accessible by any subclass of our bank account class, regardless of the package. So, if we have a savings account class that extends this bank account class, or in other terms, inherits the attributes and methods of this class, it will have direct access to all its protected properties. In this case, the savings account will be able to access the account ID property directly without the need for setters and getters. And in order to access the balance considered as private in our case, the savings account will have to use getters, setters, or any of the deposit or withdraw methods. Moreover, just like the private keyword, as it makes no sense, and since there's no such concept as sub-package or package inheritance in Java, classes cannot be made protected, but inner classes, on the other hand, can. To finish off the easy list, the public keyword, as you may have already guessed, will allow access to our attributes, methods, and classes from any other part of our application, regardless of the package, assuming, of course, that the class itself is visible to that particular part of our application. Now, what about the final keyword? When this keyword is applied to a class, it makes it impossible to extend this class. So, if our bank account class was final, we wouldn't be able to create the savings account class and inherit our bank account class properties. And when applied to a method, it prevents this method from being overridden in a subclass. So, in our case, if we were to override the deposit method in our savings account class in order to use polymorphism, yet this method was marked as final, then guess what? We can't, of course. Finally, if applied to a variable, the final keyword makes it impossible to reinitialize this variable once it has been initialized. The same applies to a class attribute. So if we were to create a final bank account instance, as shown in this example, we would be able later on to change the balance of that bank account if we want, using the deposit or withdraw methods, but we don't care about that. However, we cannot change the account ID anymore. It has to be assigned in the constructor or when instantiating the field, because it is final. In addition to this, in our code snippet, because the BA variable is final, we cannot assign a new instance of a bank account to that same variable. Or, in other terms, use the new keyword to assign a new instance to the same BA variable. Concerning the abstract keyword, when applied to a class, it makes this class impossible to instantiate. You see, instantiation is when you take something abstract and make it concrete. It is what you actually do when creating an object. So, an object reflects one concrete aspect of a given class. Think of an abstract class as a generic definition or generic blueprint, where on its own, this blueprint cannot be used to build a house, but when you add the missing bits and pieces to it, then, and only then, will you be able to use it and build 1 or 1,000 houses. Still, the building blocks reside in that initial blueprint. These missing components, the bits and pieces, are defined in a class as abstract methods, and these methods must be implemented by a subclass of that abstract class, or else these subclasses must also be declared as abstract. Abstract methods are like rules. They are defined in the abstract class or the generic blueprint, but it is up to the child classes to implement them. The abstract keyword cannot be used with variables. As some of you might have noticed here, abstract classes cannot be made final, because there will be no way of using them, as one makes a class impossible to extend, and the other makes the class unusable unless extended. We are going to conclude this Java keywords video with the static keyword. This keyword is used to declare a field, a method, or an inner class as class property. What I mean by that is, once a field is declared as static, this field will belong to the class and not the objects based on that class. And this field will be accessible before any object is created using this class. Classes maintain only one copy of these static fields or class fields and do not create multiple instances of them. You can think of static attributes as global variables. So, let's suppose that, in our example here, we have a variable we need to use named max number of subaccounts, which is equal to 4. And imagine every time we create an object using the bank account class, an integer named max number of subaccounts equal to 4 belonging to the object will be created for that object and stored in the memory. What a waste, right? Instead, we set this variable to be static and tie it to the class. Now only one instance will be available in the memory and accessible by all our objects. Static methods and classes can only operate on static stuff and cannot operate on fields bound to the object. So if I have a static method, for example, inside this method I can only make use of or reference the static fields or methods of this class. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you on the next one.